Good morning.
Hello.
It's quite early, isn't it?
It's going to be early for singing. Yeah, it's going to be interesting to hear how that goes. I'm Steve Lawson, for those of you that don't know. Thanks for the intro, Jeff. it's my job to... I think I'm just going to wind Frank up and let him go. should we start with how you are? Because I think for someone whose life has been on the road for best part of two decades, the last 16, 17 months must have been a bit of a shock.
It's been weird. It's definitely the longest period of time I've slept in the same bed since I was about 7 years old. It's been strange. In a funny way, and we can get into this, like the last month or so has almost been the hardest bit. Because there were issues back in March last year, but there was a bit of a sense of kind of adventure, almost unprecedented, a split spirit, all of this sort of business. There was a moment in time when, because everyone seems to have forgotten, at the beginning the pandemic was going to last 5 weeks or whatever it is, and something about sombreros, but there was a moment when it became clear that it was going to go on a much longer than that, and I had to cancel like 18 months worth of shows, and I had to go and kind of scream at a tree in a forest. But for the most part, I think, again, like most people, I sort of tried to sort of make the best of it and figure things out. There's an identity issue. I mean, I've been touring since I was 16 years old, and it's a bit like, who am I precisely if I'm not doing that? But I've, you know, I learned how to cook. Never really cooked anything before in my life because I was always on tour. So thank you for asking. I'm all right. I mean, the last, like I say, with the pushback and with the whole, everyone's kind of over it now. There's no novelty to it. And the enormity of the difficulties of how we're going to come back to normal and all that kind of thing are becoming quite apparent. But I'm all right. I'm hanging out with you. Life could be worse.
Hey, thank you. did it give you time to reflect on the weirdness of life on the road? Because I know you've talked about that in the past, about the strain that puts on you. Has that kind of thought process been magnified through the break?
I mean, a little bit. I mean, I sort of go back and forth on this. I mean, in some ways, the life that I usually lead is quite unusual, but then at the same time, I'm not entirely sure what a quote-unquote normal life is, or whether that's a useful concept for anybody, because everybody lives in different ways, and each of them would be unusual to someone who's not used to it. But I guess it's quite high stress. I mean, one of my concerns at the moment is that I've forgotten how to do it. And I don't mean, like, play shows, because we did the Download Festival and that kind of thing, but more like live out of a suitcase indefinitely not lose everything when I go on tour again and sleep in a bus and so on and so forth. So, you know, there's a certain kind of fitness almost, which I've maintained indefinitely. And now for the last year, I've got quite used to waking up in the same place and having my morning routine and all that kind of thing. And I suspect that it might be a bit jarring to go back to normal touring life, but then I'm not sure it's going to be a light switch moment either, so hopefully there'll be a bit of a lead-in.
I'm going to stick with touring for a while, because I think there's something quite unusual for a British musician to grow up on the road. Like you're saying, you started touring at 16, and there's historically there's been a split between British and American musicians in that we don't have that kind of touring circuit here in the country. So American musicians often live on the road and make terrible records, whereas British musicians do a handful of shows and then have to get creative in the studio because they're not road ready. Whereas you somehow, and I guess this sort of dovetails into a conversation about the punk scene and the way that as a foundation kind of established that touring thing. But
So I grew up listening to punk rock music, and I was, as a kid, I was more excited. I mean, I love The Clash, but like Black Flag in particular were great for me. And Henry Rollins wrote a book called Get in the Van, which is a history of his period of touring with Black Flag. And in the back of Get in the Van, there is their tour schedules from, I think I'm right in saying, 81 to 85. And I was that much of a friendless nerd as a teenager that I used to kind of study it and look at a map and this kind of thing. And I love that. And then the other thing was when I started out, I kind of got involved in the UK hardcore kind of DIY scene in the late 90s, which I was sort of fortunate to stumble across. But what I always remember is that there were loads of good English or UK hardcore bands, including loads from Manchester, actually, Area Effect in particular. But whenever an American touring band would come through, they would just wipe the floor with English bands. Thinking about it for 30 seconds, it's because, oh, they've done 300 shows this year, exactly. And we've done 12. Do you know what I mean? And there's just a certain kind of attitude and tightness and all that kind of thing that you get from playing that much as a group, you know? That was just my ambition when I was a kid, was to be in a band that toured a lot. I'm quite fortunate that given the way that the music industry started changing pretty much as I became a part of it, that's also quite a good way of making a living. And establishing a fan base, it turns out, as well. So, but yeah, right from the beginning, it was just like, I just want to play and play and play and play. And so I did.
I suppose there was an interesting thing in that, because with Million Dead, you started around 2000, 2001?
Yes, 2001, yeah.
So kind of right at the birth of the internet,
yeah.
as a mechanism, not just for promo, but for booking and for doing everything.
Yeah, totally. And there was definitely, I mean, it's funny because on the one hand, like, my career has pretty carefully mapped the decline of kind of the old business model and spend quite a lot of time kind of, oh no, that bit's fallen down now as well. We were about to do that. It's been quite a recurrent theme for me. But then on the flip side, I mean, you know, in Million Dead, to a degree, but particularly, so Million Dead broke up in 2005 and I decided to play an acoustic guitar and everyone thought I'd lost my mind. But it was right at the birth of kind of being able to book shows through kind of MySpace friends and that kind of business. And indeed do kind of Twitter shows at a certain point. I remember doing some charity Twitter shows in Manchester where I just sort of dropped hints as to where it was going to be all day. And then ended up having to play twice because too many people showed up, which made me feel very popular. That kind of like almost anarchic sense of connection through various bits of the internet and then social media has been quite exciting and quite useful for me. But then almost the other thing, which I have a bit of a rep for in some circles, is that my email address is public domain and always has been, and anyone can get in touch, but which is borrowed off Henry Rollins, incidentally, because I emailed Henry Rollins when I was 14, and he replied, and it changed my life, and therefore I will attempt to do the same thing. Not that I'm comparing myself to Henry Rollins, but you know, it's like that. There's something about the internet which can be quite leveling in a way that I quite enjoy. Do you know what I mean? And I like the idea that if somebody hears my records and they have something to say, they can email me.
Well, and that's quite punk. That sort of flattening of the hierarchy, because I guess community-based scenes tend not to have that elevation of the band to the top. You're actually.
Right.
You're almost like you're the entertainment at a gathering.
Right, well, but it's also, this was what appealed to me about punk rock initially, and particularly my first practical experience of it, which, as I say, was the kind of UK underground hardcore scene. I will never forget going to my first hardcore show at the Garage, and the first band finished, and they just got off the front of the stage, and the second band got out of the crowd, and it was this really, really, I've been standing next to the bass player, it was this really kind of tangible, visible idea that music was a conversation that took place within a community, and that when you're on stage, it's your go, but that's not a status that survives that 45 minutes, do you know what I mean? And nor should it. And you know, this is quite sort of dewy-eyed idealism in some ways, but it does still play a role in how I think about things. I don't like the idea that musicians are a sort of separate caste. I think that's, I mean, at best it's boring. And at worst, it's kind of a vile piece of snobbery.
I realized over a decade ago that my audience were largely more interesting than me, so meeting them and not meeting them was kind of a missed opportunity.
Sure.
But I think that when we start looking at those parallels between the American hardcore scene that inspired you and then doing that online, the level of admin suddenly kind of must, because I don't know if you've read Our Band Could Be Your Life.
It is one of my central texts.
And I remember reading that and thinking, for those of you that have never read it, if you're involved in independent music of any kind, it's an extraordinary book about the punk and independent music scene in America through the 80s. But one of the things that's clear is just how hard it was to just build the infrastructure to tour and release records. And I mean, even just waiting years to get vinyl pressed because of raising the money to pay for it.
Well, I had a brief taste of this. The first tour I did, me and my mate booked from a payphone using the BYOL bit. There was a zine called Fracture Zine that was a national hardcore zine for the UK. It was published in Cardiff, from memory. But BYOL stands for Book Your Own Life, and there was this page at the back that basically just had a list of people who might put on a show in a given town and like a landline phone number, and then lists of people who might put you up and this kind of thing. And we were 16, and we went, fuck it. And we booked a 2-week tour. It was a disaster, but it was lots of fun. But we toured before Satnav. And I always remember this. Somebody told us just before we left that if you couldn't find the venue in a given town, drive to the shit end of town and ask someone in a leather jacket. And it worked in Leeds. We couldn't find a venue, and we went to the crappiest place we could find and asked the guy in a leather jacket and went, yeah, it's over there. That was a good tip. You don't really need to do that kind of thing anymore. But, I had a taste of this, and in many ways the internet has made all of that so much easier. And that's a good thing. I don't have a huge amount of time for this kind of weird nostalgia for things being more difficult because that's just a barrier to entry, ultimately.
But I guess it does, that having that beginning, because you and I, our careers started at a very similar time.
Yeah.
And obviously in very different places. But that, because we grew up with the sense that these things were meant to be hard work, applying that hard work to the infrastructure of the internet actually made things happen.
Totally. And it's the thing that I would say to any kind of younger bands coming up is that, like, there are 24 hours in a given day, and the amount of stuff that you could do if you think creatively and outside the box. And I'm very bad at the details on this because my engagement with this level of things was 15 years ago, which is a lifetime in terms of the internet. Do you know what I mean? But, like, the example that springs to mind for me is the Lottery Winners, who are a band from this part of the world who they asked me to guest on a song, he said, promoting himself. But, you know, they've been incredibly creative with their social media. They've figured out what TikTok is, which I have not. and, you know, they've got really, really good. And that, you know, now they have management. They're putting out records. But their whole beginning was super creative, just looking at the fact the internet gives you this possibility of connecting with loads of people in an unfiltered way. But this then comes down to what you were saying earlier about it used to take ages to get vinyl pressed. Brett Gurewitz from Epitaph Records said an interesting thing to me a few years ago. He said in the 80s, and indeed in the 90s, the difficult thing was production and distribution. It was quite hard to record a record and then get it pressed and then get it in shops around the country or the world. Now, thanks to Spotify, YouTube, SoundCloud, whatever, the production distribution side of it, and indeed, you know, GarageBand, all that's easy. The difficult part now is attention. There's a scarcity of attention because there's considerably more than 24 hours of music, new music, put online every day. Yeah. So how do you make people pay attention to you and not somebody else, and indeed then come again and listen again? And that's the challenge in the industry these days. And I think that's a really good way of talking about it. And so that's what I'm saying about a band like Lottery Winners. They're fantastic. They are cutting through the noise and the static. Partly because they write fantastic songs, but also because they've presented it in an interesting and unique and kind of funny way. They've got a sense of humor, and it's been really effective.
Yeah, and I think, absolutely. I think that the symbolic capital in just having music available is no longer there, because everybody's got music available.
Yeah.
How do you actually tell the story of that becoming interesting? And from a storytelling point of view, your solo, the transition to playing solo happened at the birth of social media. So you were talking about MySpace shows.
Yeah, yeah.
But the bit of that I find fascinating is that going from a collective band and a band identity to being solo, to then being a solo artist who fronts a band, the bandness of it was still clearly very important to you. You didn't want to become Billy Bragg and just be the guy with the guitar.
Yeah, I mean, I was for
a
little while.
Did you think about that? I mean, was it that you tried it and then went, actually, I prefer the energy of a band? What happened?
No, well, because also, I hate to say this because it makes me sound like a dictator, but like it's not the same, the band that I have now and Million Dead. Million Dead
is an
egalitarian kind of democracy. Now, I love the guys I play with. They're incredible musicians. They're some of my closest friends, but it's my name on the masthead sort of thing. So there's a different dynamic within the band as a musical entity. But so, I mean, essentially, at the time when Melinda broke up, I felt quite burned. I felt like I'd been let down on various levels. I'm old enough now to realize that I wasn't as much to blame for it as anybody else. But the point was, at the time, I felt like I'd been let down. And so part of the motivation for touring solo was that I didn't have to depend on anybody else. And I didn't even need a tour manager or a vehicle. I did it all on the train. I spent about 2.5 years touring on the train, got to know the British train system incredibly well, and therefore hate it with a particular precision. Although, of course, it existed and it enabled me to do that, and that's fantastic. But yeah, so, you know, there was an independence to it which was appealing to me. And going back to the social media thing, it was literally like I was booking shows about 2 or 3 months ahead, and it was just like, if I can play anywhere, including dorm rooms at uni halls and loads of house shows, a fair few squat shows, it was just like, drop me an email, and it was 50 quid was my fee initially, which then turned into 50 quid plus my train fare once my young person's rail card ran out. Because suddenly it was more expensive, and but yeah, so you know, and it was very DIY or whatever. But I think the point about the band for me is that musically, contrary to some people's sort of fake memories, I never released music that was purely solo. Mm. I mean, a song or two per record, but it always had other instruments, and I was always interested in that. Mm. And at some point, I wanted to do that, and therefore put a band together and play with them when I can. But then that also raises the other issue, which the great flexibility of that, which I've been able to exploit, which I'm very lucky with, is that when it came to traveling overseas, I could kind of revert to type. So for a long time, I would do full band tours in the UK, and then I would go to America on my own because I couldn't afford to take the whole band over. But it didn't matter. I could still go there and play and then hopefully build things up there, which I did, into a level where the band could come. And then similar with Europe and Canada and Australia and blah, blah, blah. So it's kind of a cool model to be able to go, I'll go, gather a few people together, and then we'll all go.
But I guess that also made things like radio promo easier, because showing up with a hardcore band, you can't showing up with a acoustic guitar.
And indeed this today.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So that scalable infrastructure.
Yeah.
That's an enormous asset to have, and one that you don't have with a band.
No, totally. I didn't choose the type of music that I wanted to play because of this, but it is an advantage that I have over, let's say, a technical death metal band. And indeed, even just over the last year of lockdown, it's quite easy to play a live stream show with just you and a guitar. And in some ways, the last year, I've kind of reminded myself of that early part of my career and kind of enjoyed parts of it. Until I got so bored of live streams, I wanted to set myself on fire. But, you know, it did occur to me that friends of mine who play in more kind of involved musical acts, which are equally as valid creatively, haven't really been able to do that, or at least nowhere near as easily.
Did it allow you to tour more? Because you could do an acoustic venue circuit and then a band circuit,
Yeah, kind of. I mean, I guess I would say, you know, contrary to popular belief, there is a lot of the UK to tour. There was a band from Belfast called Jet Plane Landing when Million Dead was starting out. They were kind of our heroes, and actually Cahir is now in my band. They did a 60-date tour of the UK, and everyone was like, what? And it's like, it can be done, just nobody ever does. And similarly, like, I mean, I played in Boston, Lincolnshire in 2019, and it was, in 2020, early 2020, it was one of the best shows I ever did. And we talked about the fact that in the 70s and the 60s, you know, they'd had that venue, the Glidodrome, had had Zeppelin and the Beatles and Who and all these people come through. And they were like, no one plays here anymore apart from you and the Levellers. And it was just, in fairness, I learned some of this off the Levellers because they took me on tour early doors, and they sort of said to me, play the regional shows and you will build a sustainable career. And just people, there's so many people, including people from this country, think that a UK tour, it's okay to just do Glasgow, Manchester, Birmingham, London, Southampton, maybe Bristol.
Yeah.
And it's just like, what are you talking about? Mm. Like, there's some of my favorite gigs have been in Norwich. True. And it's just, there are loads of places to play. It's just, I think that there is a bit of a laziness with regards to touring in some corners of the industry over here, because you can do a tour like that and you can sell out academy level venues and feel very pleased with yourself. And it's going to be harder work to go and do a month of shows at the same level or a slightly smaller level to make it work or whatever. But it's worth doing if you want to build a long-term career.
And I think that desire for a long-term career is, I guess that your understanding of that was informed by the punk ethic behind it.
I mean,
your idea of success clearly wasn't number one hits from the start.
My idea of success, to be blunt, was not having a telesales job anymore, which I did for a time because, as we all know, that's the kind of job where you can come and go for tours. So, but now we're going to talk about the graph.
Yeah, let's talk about
the
graph.
Let's talk about, I've got this grand theory of the graph, right? If you had a graph where on the, is it the Y one that goes up and down?
Yeah.
The Y axis is success, and then you've got time going along.
Yeah.
Like most people's careers, you sort of go up, and you reach a sort of peak, and then it comes down again a bit, because it does for everybody. I hate to break this to young bands who are doing well. And then it sort of levels out at a certain point. And the question is, that line where it levels out that's a bit lower than the peak, is that above or below the horizontal line that says, must have another job? Do you see what I mean?
I do, that's a fantastic
graph. And I think about this endlessly, and I think just about now, 20 years into my career, I'm starting to believe that maybe my line has settled above the job line.
Right.
And I'm probably not going to have to get another job anytime soon, at any rate. And that's that to me, that's success. There it is. Phone down. Like, I mean, that's all I ever really wanted, and that's what I've got, and I feel incredibly privileged.
Which is a sustainability thing, I guess. That it's can I keep doing this?
Yeah.
It's a bigger thing than can I have a hit. Is how do I keep doing this?
Yeah, and then we're talking about the kind of business side of this. There is, of course, the creative aspect of it as well, in the sense that, like, do I still have things to say? Am I repeating myself? You know, with every record I make, I'm in the middle of mixing my 9th record. Like, I think a lot about why anybody would care about anyone's 9th record. It's not an exciting statement. and I like to think that I've been through that self-examination, and I think I do think I have things to say, and I think it is different enough to things I've done before, and so on and so forth. But you have to think about that. That's a different form of sustainability.
I think this might be a nice chance for you to say something with a guitar in your hands.
Okay. That was a segue.
That was, wasn't it?
Wasn't it?
Look
at that.
That. Yeah, we kind of made that look seamless, I think.
I didn't know, by the way, that this was apparently the first time anyone's played and made any noise on this stage since the pandemic started, and that's cool. I've played here before at some point. Definitely familiar. This is a song that is from the forthcoming record. It's the only one that's out, but it's a song about the end of, well, it's about live music, and it's about the end of a pandemic and about kind of what we're all hoping to return to. The song's called The Gathering, and it goes like this. The first time that the beat drops in the bar, it's gonna be biblical. The second that the sing-along starts, it'll be sensational. So sound the alarms and the sirens are churches. Bring your parents and your kids into the streets. Throw open the hatches. I've been missing the feeling room because of the gaps between us. It's better than the best benediction, more bracing than bloodlust. Cause we've been waiting and wondering, practicing and praying, saving and slavery, gathering ourselves to the gathering. We've been huddled in our houses for however many days like survivors. And we've been dutifully paying our dues and paying heed to our advisors. Oh, but we're pent up and we're pissed off and we're perilously close to the precipice. Yeah, we're butterflies in ballet shoes and brothel creepers coming out of our chrysalis. It comes down to this. Because of the gaps between us. It's better than the best benediction, more bracing than bloodlust. Cause we've been waiting and wondering, practicing and praying, saving and slavering, gathering ourselves to the gathering. All together now. We'll be right back.
This is our mantra. We gather together, we look out for each other, and we got strength in our numbers. This is our mantra. We gather together, we look out for each other, we got strength in our numbers. And I'll be the preacher, and this is the scripture. Once more with feeling, this is a gathering. Gather together, gather together.
Oh, it's early. Thank you.
Amazing.
I warned you, sound guys, that I was going to sing louder than I talk.
It's quite extraordinary to sit this far away from you projecting like that. It's kind of, it's sort of, because if you were singing to me like that, I'd be terrified. Like, you're just going to start screaming in my face. When you're writing, are you aware of the context that you're writing for? Is because I guess because your live career works on so many levels, from arenas and stadiums and the sports tours to house shows, does any of that factor in how you're thinking about writing?
It did briefly, and it was a mistake. I hate saying this, because if people like it, that's fine, but I have issues with the presentation of my third record, which is entirely my fault. But at the time, I'd sort of got to the point of playing Shepherd's Bush Empire, let's say, and indeed the trajectory seemed to be heading upwards, which it was. And I sort of sat there and thought, well, now I need to write music that, or maybe not write music, but certainly arrange music in a way that will work in a bigger space and this kind of thing. And therefore, made some creative decisions that in retrospect are slightly kind of ersatz. And I regret that, and maybe if I turn into Kate Bush, I will go and re-record that record one day with different arrangements. I love Kate Bush, but you know what I mean? She's re-recorded. And so, or Taylor Swift, maybe.
Joni Mitchell.
Joni Mitchell, there you go. I look back at that now, and I kind of figured at the time, I realized as we were touring that record that I'd got a bit grandiose, I suppose is the point. And that actually, similar with the whole thing that on the following album cycle I did, I got to my first arena headline show. We headlined Wembley Arena in 2012. And I remember planning the show, thinking to myself, well, I need to write a whole different set list now because it's an arena gig. And then, thankfully, had the presence of mind to go, hold on a minute. Like, you got to this point by doing a certain thing. And I'm not saying the same set list every night, but, you know, a certain method of presentation. Don't now change it. Because do you know what I mean? That's not the point. The point is that thing has been successful to this point. Maybe change it down the line for creative reasons. Don't change it because you now consider yourself to be an arena artist. Do you know what I mean?
But that, I suppose that comes back to what you were saying before about there being, you've got this the graph which is about success and sustainability, but there is that creative parallel graph that is, am I still doing things that are worthwhile?
A second graph. Yes.
I have another graph for you, which we might get into in a bit. But I think that conflict between context and creativity and kind of, because I suppose the classic example is Damien Rice, who got to a certain point and went, I don't want to play venues this big. I'm too famous for my own for what I want to do.
Yeah.
But you seem to straddle that well.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I think that's partly because my popularity is not kind of cast iron and it goes up and down. But I mean, I take pride in the ability to kind of, to hopefully be adaptable enough with my band and my crew to present well in different spaces. I mean, funnily enough, I feel quite strongly like the sort of 2000 cap-ish is probably where we shine. Nottingham Rock City is my favourite venue ever. And tattooed on my arm. And, you know, that's probably our sweet spot. But at the same time, I think we can put on a good arena show and we can put on a good club show and I can still play in someone's house if required.
And you've played arenas as a support act solo?
Yes, I have, which is a challenge.
Because this is where my graph comes in. Because I have a graph that I've used in the past to talk about the concept of a sort of primary and a secondary audience. So you have the people who love what you do and then the people who discover you through those other things. And you're basically trying to transition people from one to the other.
Yeah, absolutely.
What I mean, can you talk about support tours? Have they? How significant have they been to you?
Enormously significant, and indeed, this is a thing that is worth discussing. To the idea that this is angled towards anybody who is looking for tips, support tours is the thing, and particularly for me. I mean, so I had some great support slots in the UK. The Levelers have a long history of being supportive of emerging talent, and hats off to them for that. And indeed, I try and replicate that in my own way. As in taking up new bands that I believe in as supports for myself. So I did that. I had a lovely support tour with Biffy in 2007, which was great because quite a lot of people who like Million Dead like Biffy, and it was the tour where I really kind of got the message out to people that I was doing something after Million Dead. Quite a lot of people were like, oh my God, it's the guy from Million Dead. And it's like, I've been doing this for 2.5 years already. Word travels slow, it turns out. So that was cool. There was a bunch of stuff like that. But the real one for me was the States. So the first big support I had in the States was opening for The Offspring on an arena tour on the East Coast when I was playing solo. And that was a challenge. No one had heard of me. I was playing before Sum 41 and The Offspring. I had one acoustic guitar and an English accent and, you know, 5,000 to 10,000 sunburnt, pissed Offspring fans every day. And it was an interesting tour because I just sort of soldiered on, put my head down and went, fuck it, got to do this. And came out of the tour thinking that it hadn't been super worthwhile. But part of the reason for that is that those venues are of a size that it's quite difficult to then interact. I wasn't allowed to go and sell my own merch because they had concessions and all this going on. And usually, top tip for any emerging bands, sell your own merch up until you're playing to 1,000 people a night at least. Headline. And if you're ever a support act, sell your own merch. Good Lord. First of all, you save money on a merch person. Secondly, you get to meet people and create a connection and become memorable to them. After that Offspring tour, I have met quite a lot of people who say that they saw me at those shows. And indeed, kind of respected the balls of just going out and going, afternoon. And all these people like,
At that scale, you don't actually need that many people to love what you do to make a significant impact on your primary audience.
10% of people pay attention, that's still 500 people. Do you know what I mean? Of a 5,000 capacity audience. That's a lot of people. And if 10% of them fall in love with you or whatever, that's 50 people. That's pretty good. And maybe the numbers will be higher than that. But I did that, and then the next thing that happened, which goes back to what we were talking about, we got a tour opening for Flogging Molly in 2010, and the fee was not superb. No, I love the Flogging Molly guys, they're dear friends of mine, but I think part of the reason we got the tour is that we were cheap. And the money was just so nonsensical. We were losing so much money every day that basically I did my own merch on it. And we were playing sort of 2,000 to 5,000 people a night on that tour, and I would... We get to the venue, I count t-shirts in, go and do a sound check, eat some food, sell from doors until our set, run off, do the set, run straight back and sell until the end of the night, and did that every single night. And we had fill shows on the off days, and it was 3 months, and it was utterly brutal. But we made the books balance just about at the end of it because we sold so many CDs and t-shirts. And also, it knocked us into shape as a band, like you would not believe. Playing every night and playing to, there's something so satisfying about being a support act if you succeed at it, in the sense that you walk on stage and most people go, and then if you walk off and you get a big cheer, then it's a real tangible achievement. You've got 30 minutes, 45 minutes, whatever it is, to make an impact, and it hones your chops as a performer like you wouldn't believe. Because we did Flogging Molly, then we did ages with Social D, Dropkick Murphys, Social D again. You know, we just went round and round and round the States grinding for years. And I'm very proud of the fact we did it and we built an audience. And quite a lot of English bands or UK bands have an audience in Chicago, LA, Boston, New York kind of thing. And like, I've played Ohio so many times, I have a tattoo of the state. I can sell out venues in New Mexico. Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's cool.
Which is, I mean, the archetype for that, for a British band, was U2.
Yeah.
That they went out and did, they would do 8 months of the year playing initially youth clubs, then high schools, then, you know, and they just kind of built up over time.
And less fashionably, Def Leppard.
Oh, did they? Did they do the hard graft?
They really did. And they got castigated in the UK for doing it because people were like, oh, too big for England now. But they were actually doing the hard graft, as far as I understand it.
And it does, and it, I mean, it makes an enormous difference in the States. But it also, coming back to the thing we were talking about earlier on, about American bands coming over here and blowing our minds because they perform so well,
yeah.
You gain the reputation that you have as a live performer.
Right, but so this then gets to another thing that I think is really important. I wish somebody had explained to me earlier in my life that there are three separate jobs. I'm a musician, I'm a songwriter, and I'm a performer. And those are three different skill sets. And hopefully they intersect and you do all three of them well. But it's entirely possible to be good at one or two and not all three. I know plenty of people, I can think of plenty of people who are great songwriters and great musicians and terrible performers, or great songwriters and great performers and terrible musicians. Kurt Cobain springs to mind, who's one of my all-time favorites, but he wasn't a particularly gifted guitar player, I don't think. No. And then similarly, you can have people who are great performers and great musicians and terrible songwriters, Dream Theater. But, you know, so... Sorry. I mean, they're hilarious. But so do you see what I mean? Like, there are all of these different things. And I guess the point is that there's a weird thing, particularly in punk rock, that the idea of considering yourself to be a performer, or dare I to use the word entertainer, is kind of not cool. Or so there's something kind of compromised about that. But that's bollocks. Like, if you're charging people money to stand in front of you while you play music every day, you are an entertainer, and I don't care how you feel about that. And therefore, try and be good at it.
Well, there's an interesting parallel there with the way that Chuck D talks about hip hop and the need to put on a show. And it's like that it's not just posturing; it's like you need to go out and entertain, and that's what people are paying to see. Even if you're also an activist.
But exactly, and your activism will land harder if you can engage people more. Yeah. And whilst I don't consider myself I don't consider myself smart and measured enough to be a political activist, is the truth. But in terms of presenting my music, it's like the songwriting that I care about very deeply will go over better if it's presented well.
But of the causes that you support, not as an activist, you tend to choose ones that are that sit well with who you are as a public persona.
Of course. I mean, I guess. We're now on the topic, good Lord. But like, you know, for me, I think that one of the things, I mean, first of all, like, I'm not very good at, like, holding my nerve, holding my temper and that kind of thing when it comes to talking about politics. And I've made an ass of myself talking about politics in the past and all the rest of it. And I guess at some point I just sort of took a decision that my activism, such as it is, would be music related, because music is a thing I definitely know about and I'm not talking out of my ass when I talk about it. So, you know, I care about things like... disabled rights, but my choice is to support Able to UK, who specifically deal with disabled access to music venues. Now, you might argue that's slightly parochial and that there are wider societal issues, and I think you're right, but at the same time, you know, this is the corner of the world that I know and can definitely affect, and it feels more focused to me to do that kind of thing. I'm wearing a Calling All Crows t-shirt today, which is the American version, as it were, of Safe Gigs for Women. We've done stuff with Stay Up Late, who do getting people with learning disabilities into shows. All of these issues are much broader than just how they interact with gigs. But I do gigs, so it seems that that's a better use of my time.
Maybe we can come back to this in a moment, because that level of self-reflection, of seeing that and protecting yourself from the bubble that says your opinion on everything matters and you need to be heard on every issue, which...
Oh, and I'm sure I've been guilty of that myself at certain times. And I look at the function of Facebook memories fills me with shuddering horror almost every day, because I used to talk a lot of bollocks. And this is a function of surviving this long in the industry to be self-aware. It's not something that came easily. I try and be kind of. I think this is true of anybody. The older you get, you realise the less you know, and how little you understand about anything, really. And I try and kind of factor that into my decision making.
But you do, when needed, you leverage that position.
Yeah, totally.
So that the streaming gigs for the music venues. Trust, that's an extraordinary level of just. I mean, Bev gave us the headline figure of 83 million or whatever it is that they've managed to do. But you raised over 200 grand just through your streaming shows.
The thing is, because I wasn't actually running the fundraisers myself. I did the first couple and then my bank got really, really weird about it. So the idea, which was a better one, was to let the venue set up a fundraising page and I just point people at it. So it's about 250 grand that came in over 26 shows.
Should we give him a round of applause? That's an extraordinary thing to do.
Well, thank you. I feel duty bound to say that, first of all, I didn't give anybody 250 grand. I don't have 250 grand. And secondly, there was a level of self-interest to it in the sense that I was busy keeping myself sane during lockdown. Do you know what I mean? It gave me something to do each week. And like a lot of people saying to me, oh, it's great having this Thursday night, so I know when it's Thursday. And it was like, me too. and it's like, because there was a point when it was quite hard to judge what day of the week it was. You know what I mean? So having a Thursday night thing. But anyway, I'm proud of it. It was a good thing to do. You know, there were definitely the most important upshot of it for me is there have been one or two venues who've like dropped me a line just saying, you know, you got us across the line in a certain period of time that we wouldn't have made otherwise. And then these are venues that I know and love, and that makes me very, very happy.
And you do have a strong connection with venues going back to the Agents of Change campaign, which your own petition kickstarted.
Yes, I wrote the foreword for a petition that other smart people wrote, but yes, thank you, it was my petition. So I've been working with MVT for years, which incidentally goes to show that there are genuinely people who seem to think that people run venues to become millionaires, and it's just like, fucking hell, what are you talking about? It's a cause that required assistance at before there was a pandemic. But I have a lot of friends who run music venues. I know Pat from The Joiners incredibly well. I know the crew at the Railway. Yeah. I know the team at the Cavern. And in a lot of cases, these are people who've been booking me since like the late 90s in some instances. So we're friends. And like as much as my career was put on hold in terms of being a live performer in March 2020, it was obvious to me that people whose entire business model revolved around gathering people together in confined spaces were going to be fucked by this and could do with some help.
There was a quote, I think you said it to the NME, that I found super insightful about this. In that so much of the conversation around small music venue economies has been, this is the training ground for future stars.
Yeah.
And you said, it's also a place where music exists for itself, and this is an important cultural space where you can make music to live within small venues. And
completely.
And I think that's a very rare voice to hear within that space.
The thing is, I get why people talk about the training ground thing and go, look, Ed Sheeran played small venues, and so did Adele, and so did Radiohead, and whatever else.
I did Ed back in the day.
Huh?
I did gigs with Ed back in the day.
I've not met him, but I'm told he's a nice person. So, and indeed, hats off.
He was nice when he was 16 or 17. Yeah, or whatever it was that I played shows.
But you know, and he did the hard graft and has written some great songs. Anyway, like I understand why people focus on that because it's a way of gaining attention from the sort of like broader public and indeed from people like government ministers, and it is a savvy part of campaigning, and I accept all of that. But many of my favorite bands will never play anywhere bigger than the Garage at a stretch, do you know what I mean? And I love them, and there's a huge culture of weird, awkward, underground, noisy music, and that I love more than I love arena rock. Do you know what I mean?
And like, and I think that around that, and this is perhaps an interesting bridge over into talking about social media and the way that it twists our perceptions. There's a sort of steady state economy around that it's not about growth. It's about, can we keep doing this for these spaces? Can these gatherings which matter to us keep happening around this weird, freaky music? And yet, so often now, because the carrot is dangling in front of us of doing big numbers on Spotify or big numbers of Facebook followers, we see numbers in there, hundreds of thousands or even millions, and think that that's what matters in a way that makes a gig to 75 people feel like failure.
I know what you mean. I mean, the music industry has long been obsessed with numbers because it used to be, I think part of the reason people are obsessed with things like Spotify plays and followers and all the rest of it is because they can no longer obsess over record sales, or at least not in a way that leads to anything other than horrible tears. But I take your point. I mean, social media is a tool, and much like fire, you can either cook your food or set yourself on fire and burn your house down with it. And I've done both. Good Lord.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really difficult. Social media, particularly Twitter, which is miles and away the worst part of it, but the others have their demons. It gives you this kind of weird suggestion that it's possible for example, to have a conversation with 160,000 people at the same time. Of course it isn't. What a ridiculous thing. But even more than that, and particularly for younger bands, I think this is a real minefield. It gives you this idea that you can kind of drop a microphone into every conversation about you that's happening everywhere in the world. Yeah. And first of all, you can't do that. And secondly, why on earth would you want to do that? One of the things is, it's quite easy to be an underground act, because definitionally, the people who know about you are people who like you. Yep. And almost you might say that the definition of becoming in any way mainstream is being exposed to a non-pre-selected audience. And not everyone's going to like you. And indeed, from my point of view, I can't spend my life jumping up and down going, look at me, I exist, and then be sad when not everybody thinks I'm the bee's knees. That's ridiculous. And it took me a while to accept that. You know, but if you're having... if you're having, you know, records played on the radio, you're not, you're being exposed to a non-pre-selected audience, and not everyone's going to like you. But even on the underground level, there's probably somebody bitching about you somewhere. And this was true. There were people bitching about Led Zeppelin endlessly, but Led Zeppelin didn't try and listen to every single one of them, and therefore they didn't go insane. They went insane for other reasons. you know what I mean? But
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
But it's and I've been guilty of, well, I've been susceptible to this. Endlessly, this idea, you know, I mean, and there are people, and not many people will admit it, and I don't do this anymore, but there was a time where you have a kind of search alert for your name, not just your tag, but for your name. And
I do.
but if you, at a certain point, that's insanity in an object that sits in your pocket. Mm. And it's this kind of, it's awful, and like doom scrolling, whatever people call it these days, but like, it's a really bad idea. And then you... then also factor in the fact of the way that people behave on Twitter. You remove social cues, which means people talk. They don't think, 9 times out of 10, if somebody says something abusive to me, on the past on Twitter, and if I'd respond, they would quite often respond with, oh, I didn't think you'd read that. And it's like, tagged me in it. Mm. Like, what? And I get this on my email to this day, because of course I get some abusive emails, and I've learned the hard way that you win an argument by being considerate and calm and rational. And 99 times out of 100, if you do that on your email, people go, oh my God, I never thought you'd read it. And you're like, you sent an email to my email address. What did you think I was going to do with it? Yeah. Anyway, but so I think that it's really dangerous for mental health. It's been catastrophic for my mental health at certain points in time. And being on the receiving end of a Twitter storm or monstering or whatever is a miserable fucking thing. And indeed, I feel... at the risk of now getting a little bit kind of forthright, I feel very strongly that it's not something that people should talk too much about if they've not experienced it themselves. It is fucking horrible. Mm. And until you've been on the... because there are people who are like, oh, it's not that bad, you know, or you've still got fans and blah, blah, blah. And all of that's true, but it's fucking horrible. And I've had periods of time where I've not slept or eaten for days because of this shit going on. And at a certain point, you realize that if you just turn it off and put your phone away and walk down the street, nobody... the question I have asked myself, which was very useful for me, mental health, is, you know, I've sort of said to my mum, like, oh, I'm having this horrible time. Everybody's calling me an asshole for this, that, or the other. And she goes, well, where? And that's a good question. Where is this happening in physical terms? And it's not really happening anywhere physical. And you can walk down a high street and not a single person you walk past will know what's going on. So... turn it off and put it away. These days I use social media as a broadcast tool. I don't expect it to be conversational. And it is for some people, and that's fine, but just at a certain point you have to step away from the idea that you can have a conversation with hundreds of thousands of people at the same time.
I think there's probably an aspect of scale to that.
Totally.
As a new artist with 500 followers, talking to them...
it's probably a good idea, you should do that. Yes, absolutely, you're right about that. But I think that... and I do feel like some of the majors now sort of have people who are talking to younger bands about this and trying to kind of get them to step away at a certain point or limit their amount of time on it or whatever. But it's... I mean, and then for me, I balance it by having the email address thing.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's like people are like, well, I tweeted you 8 times, and it's like... yes, you clicked past my email address to do that, but crack on.
Yeah.
do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
My point being, there is a method of having a conversation.
Yeah.
But this is the thing, conversations on Twitter are necessarily performative.
Yes.
And like, there are people who have taken issue with something that I might have said somewhere, and they do it on Twitter, and I've sent them an email and said, listen, if there's an issue that we should discuss, let's do this. And they have no interest in doing an email because they don't score points in the school cafeteria that is Twitter, in that they want to have a performative public conversation. And I'm not super interested in that.
There's, I guess, what it points to is that there's a huge problem with the idea that there is a way of doing social media that
yeah.
leads to a particular kind of success without interrogating what that success is, what the downside is, yeah. what the scale of the act is.
Yeah,
there's a ton of stuff there that, that
yeah.
is potentially, again, can mess with your mental health in ways
totally.
that are
I guess,
hugely damaging.
Yeah, I guess what I'd say, there's definitely some people who are very good at it. I mean, the example I always think of is Jason Isbell, who is an American country singer, who's a good friend of mine, but like, he's fantastic at Twitter yeah. because he's very funny and he's got great waspish comebacks to people having a go at him, and he's kind of entertaining. And I actually kind of came a cropper trying to be a bit like him, or trying to treat my social media like him, and I'm just not level-headed and funny enough to yeah. pull it off, and I ended up looking like a brittle dickhead, essentially. And so some people are good at it, and hats off to them, and I think it's helped his career, but like, I just, you at a certain point have to recognize what your strengths and weaknesses are.
But it's back to that analysis you did earlier on, where you talked about being a musician, a performer, and a songwriter.
Yeah.
And being, social media management is its own job.
Totally.
And if you're good at that and you can do it and separate those two hats, then great, do
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
But make sure you keep some distance from it.
Totally. And there's something so personal about it, which often isn't intended to be. Particularly, incidentally, if you're a solo artist.
Yeah.
If somebody has a go at your band, you still exist outside of that. But people, yeah. when people want to have a go at me, they say, "I hate you," and I go, "But we've never met."
Yeah.
Like, what? And it's quite upsetting.
There's a lovely moment on a James Taylor gig where the opposite happens, and a woman shouts, "I love you, James," it's on his live record. And he says, "Good. I think it helps us not to know each other." It's good because he recognizes that relationship,
yeah,
the
yeah,
artist-fan
sure.
relationship, is one that's built on not knowing.
Yeah, yeah.
And on that performance that you were talking about, and that online, that performativity can be masked and can look like friendliness.
Yeah, yeah.
That is.
Well, in a way, there's somewhere in there is the secret, which is to look kind of friendly and approachable whilst also not actually being that. I don't know how to do it.
But I think that not knowing is central to what's actually going on. Because
yeah.
I think that you've been quite open about struggles with mental health and a journey into sobriety to get through that.
Comparative sobriety.
Yeah.
I had a glass of wine last night, and boy, did I feel it this morning. but it's a big step down from what my nights out of Manchester used to look like.
But I think that's the thing that musicians need to deal with is the more of the stuff you can actually deal with ahead of time, of going, I get to that point where I'm hammered every night. I remember watching Strange Kind of Monster and James Hetfield saying he'd never been on stage sober.
Yeah, yeah.
Thinking, wow, what an extraordinary thing.
Yeah, yeah. I think this is a thing I think about quite a lot, in the sense that when I first started touring, there were just no grown-ups in the room. Like, you know, the oldest person I met on tour for quite a long time would have been like 30, maybe. You know, there were just no grown-ups around and no one telling us how to do it. And that's kind of cool on some levels. Mm. But at the same time, there was also kind of this idea that tour should be this endless stag do. And you know, there's a sort of bravado and a romanticism to it, which I get, and you know, and it can be a lot of fun, but at the same time, certain people can handle that and certain people can't, and that ability is not correlated with musical skill, necessarily, do you know what I mean? And there are definitely, I'm not now going to be bitchy, but there are definitely kind of older musicians who I think's chief skill was to not die of a heroin overdose when everyone else did.
Yeah.
You know, and and I just think that occasionally it's a good piece of advice to say to people, it is okay to just go to bed some nights.
Yeah.
And, or at the very least, just focus on the fact that you have to sing tomorrow. Do you know what I mean? That, particularly as I've got older, that's the main thing for me. I can't party like I did when I was in my 20s, full stop. But also, if I do, I just can't even open my mouth the following day. Just kind of remembering that you're a musician first and foremost. And almost in a way, if the partying side of it is more interesting to you, then, like, are you in the right job anyway?
Yeah. Maybe you should work behind the bar rather than be on the stage. Frank, thank you so much for this. I think it would be great to finish with a song.
I have an idea.
You have an idea?
Of course I do. Thank you. This has been fun. Thank you for listening to me blather for ages. Sound guys, you'll be relieved to hear that this is a finger-picking number. and comparatively gentle. And this is me tuning my guitar. This is a song that I kind of wrote that was a that is relevant to everything we were just saying about social media and the idea of trying to be more considerate as I get older and just less brittle. there was the late great Clive James, who is one of my favorite writers, who passed away in 2019, sadly. Wrote a poem called Les Ondes Ténèbres, which features the line, "I should have been more kind. It is my fate to find this out, but find it out too late." And I read that and decided that I was going to try and take action on it before I was terminally ill. So this song's called Be More Kind. History's been leaning on me lately. I can feel the future breathing down my neck. And all the things I thought were true when I was young and you were too turned out to be broken. And I don't know what comes next in a world that has decided that it's going to lose its mind. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. They've started raising walls around the world now, like hackles raised upon a cornered cat. On the borders in our heads between the things that can and can't be said, we've stopped talking to each other. There's something wrong with that. So before you go out searching, don't decide what you will find. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. And you should know you're not alone. And trouble comes and trouble goes. And how this ends, no one knows. So hold on tight. To sand and sea, and where the dry land stands is hard to say. As the current drags us by the shore, we can no longer say for sure who's drowning or if they can be saved. So when you're thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, the wonderful and lovely Frank Turner.
Thank you.